as they often do. You gotta stay with it, you gotta stay with it. When the world pulls a fast switcheroo, you gotta stay with it, you gotta stay with it. Stay with the truth, yeah. Stay with the truth, yeah. Stay with the truth, and the truth will stay with you.
All right. Time to put the pedal to the metal. We have 17 days till December 21st. And today was a day of transition back into intensity. There was Thanksgiving. There was a time build up to Thanksgiving of intensity. Took a little break for Thanksgiving. A lot of storms came in, and now things are going to clear out. One more storm tonight, things are going to clear out. 17 more days to December 21st. It is time to get intense about preparations, and it was suggested today to me to go on more of a fruit diet and start drinking grapefruit juice during the day for breakfast and for lunch. Have grapefruit juice and transition into fruit like papaya, pears, blueberries, pineapple, various fruits. Get into that more. Cut out the heavy stuff right now, because there is something going on. We're experiencing lightheadedness, giddiness, lightheadedness, a bit unstable. And there's something going on. It's been suggested that there's some sort of expansion. Something's happening. And it was very clearly indicated to me that I should start going into some kind of grapefruit juice diet, as it were. I've done that before, a grapefruit juice diet. Shed some more pounds, slim down, let the system really be free of heaviness, because we're lightening up, and it's been suggested to drop the feeling of being a heavyweight, like a body, like you're heavy and you're dense. Drop the density. Those who really are going to make it through these times will feel very light, like they're becoming lighter and lighter and lighter, not heavier and heavier and heavier. And it may be that men have a hard time with this, because they're supposed to do the hard, heavy work, which I do quite a bit of, actually. I actually injured myself this weekend just trying to clean up after storms, doing heavy work. And but really, those we need to start feeling lighter and lighter and lighter, like we're floating. That is the way to go right now. Get with this lightening that's taking place. So, from a practical standpoint, we need to make an all-out push, and I'm going to try to do that. Maybe get up earlier, do more stretching. I did do more running. I ran for 20 minutes today instead of 12. Longer route. Start taking in juice and fruits, fruit juice and fruits. Maybe half of the diet, or even more, or all the way if you can. And then morning meditation, evening meditation, and make an all-out push to the finish line. We can see the finish line is right there. It's 17 days away. So what we mean by finish line is we mean a milestone that's been out there for a long time for a lot of people. Of course, the media and NASA and mainstream media dismisses it as saying, well, the Mayans just ran out of space on their calendar. Well, how come the calendar, the long count, ends at the end of a vast long count cycle, 26,000-something years, aligning with the galactic center? How come it just happens to end at that point? Did they really just run out of space, or did they know what they were doing? They knew what they were doing. The cycle is coming to an end. A long, long, long cycle coming to an end. And the key is, we don't want to continue on with the cycles of crises and problems and trying to solve problems. They call it learning, but it's really being faced with threats to your survival. And we don't need to do that, because really we're children of reality, which has no threat to its survival whatsoever. So we don't want to get pulled into this another long cycle. And so the opportunity is here, and we're feeling a big boost coming. It is very close now. And so we need to do everything we can at this time, even if we don't we feel lazy, we feel inertia. That's what I've been feeling, like, I don't want to do anything anymore, I'm tired, all that stuff. Well, we can use our will a little bit to push that aside for a little bit. For 17 days, we can do it. And in doing it, we will be vastly better off than not doing it. This is the time when the tough times get tough, the tough get going. This is the time before Christmas hits this year, before Christmas hits this year, to be in tip-top condition in all ways. In all ways. Flexibility, balance, cardio, stamina, diet, weight, calmness, clarity, fearlessness, courage, decisiveness, all this stuff, tip-top shape. If not now, when? This is the best time possible. The motivation is extreme. And I'm pretty amazed there hasn't been more talk about this date coming up. It's almost like that pastor back in last year said, like, March, what do you say, March something, 821st was going to be the end of the world. And then he said, well, no, it's October 21st, end of the world. And it's almost like that severely undermined the whole notion of this December 21st as being the end of a cycle, a long cycle. And anybody who talks out, you know, is ridiculed. Oh, no, the media said it's okay and nothing's going to happen. Okay. That is what happens in this world. I have seen that belief anticipates threats to its authority and preemptively does things to undermine anybody who might stand up to belief and make them seem like a fool, make them seem like an idiot, a fool. So there's all those billboards, weren't there? March 21st, end of the world, all over the country. It was a huge thing. And nothing happened. And so people now say, look down their noses at anybody who says, hey, there's an important date coming up. There's an important time. This is a transition point. December 21st, 2012 is a transition point. And then the transit begins into some new cycle for those who want to be in another cycle. It also is a point where those can be very decisive to say, wait a minute, no, we're not going into a new cycle. And for those, the options might be quite extraordinary, quite miraculous, quite wonderful, actually. And expect that they will be. So at any rate, we don't have to go out with billboards in the street saying that, well, the end is here, the end is here. Of course you're going to get ridiculed, but we can quietly, unobtrusively, anonymously, just go about our business with intensity and do the right things right now to really, really be on point at that time. And I expect to be. I've gotten some injuries and some difficulties, but you know what? We'll just have to push on through. So whatever it is, pay attention to unusual stuff that just are anomalies in your life. Usually those are attention getters, and they'll tell you what to do. It's amazing how miracles happen in your life because it's custom for you. Other people, if you tell them about it, they'll just say, oh, you're nuts. But to you, it's significant. You'll see something and say, wait a minute. That's not supposed to be there. That is really completely anomalous. And then you'll pick it up, you'll look at it, or do something. Something will happen to you, and it'll be like really weird. And like you just say, "Whoa! I wonder if this is some kind of way to get my attention." And then suddenly you realize, "My gosh! I was just thinking about doing that." And then there's a confirmation in a very anomalous, strange way. And you say, "Wow, maybe." And then it clicks, and you say, "Yeah, that's exactly what I need to do." That's what happened to me today. I know I'm supposed to get on this fruit diet, but I just won't do it. Now I realize, you know what? I just have to do it. Have to do it. Because, of course, it lightens you up, right? It lightens you up. And I keep thinking that to deal with this world, you need to be heavy enough to... There's a lot of stuff I have to do that I have to really use my weight and strength and to deal with things that way. But right now, it seems in this transitional period we're going through, lightening up is the key. which means I'm going to have to drop some more weight. I set a goal. Set a goal for your stuff. Like December 21st, you want to be a certain weight. You want to, you know, set goals so that way you're pressured to reach them. And you can't just say, well, it's an open-ended thing. Maybe I'll, you know, by next year, I don't know. It just goes on and on and on and on and on. So December 21st, 70 days, set goals. Set goals. And be determined to reach them. And I would say right now it is time to shed any remaining reluctance to get with it. It's really time. There's no more time to waste. And so I realized that. Okay. Let's do it. Let's do it. Let's do it. So I will be giving out encouragement probably daily if I can. Daily encouragement to all those who are really going for it. Whatever you're doing that is right for you. Stay with it. Stay with the truth. The truth will stay with you. Go 100%. Not crazy. Don't wipe yourself out. But be relentless. Be dedicated. Just stay within your dedication to being the best that you can be. Because their upcoming will be decision points of decision, points of choosing, where you have to be clear about what you really want. And you have to choose what you really want. And that will come upon you like a thief in the night. And you will have to feel like you can do it. Now, that's the pragmatic, practical side of the situation right now, which I will continue to emphasize. Maybe I'll share my diet. Just not that you're supposed to do the same thing, but just to give you an idea, you can start thinking along the lines of like, what is my diet supposed to be? Think about that. Say, how can I lighten up? Really lighten up. I don't want to be just eating huge amounts of heavy food. That'll bog you down. For instance, today I gave away my hot sauce, my ghost pepper hot sauce today. I'm now off all hot sauce, off of it. I was giving a bad reaction to me, causing me troubles, and I realized that this is not the right thing, and so I gave it away. I'm going to give the rest of that away. I'm not going to have any more hot sauce in my food whatsoever. I used to have it breakfast, lunch, and dinner. It was my seasoning, but that's it. I decided that yesterday, that's it, no more. It's not the right thing anymore. So these are decisions. I guarantee you can find some things in your life, some issues, where you can decide this isn't the right thing for me in my life, and that's it. No more. No mas. And literally decide, okay, for right now, for this next phase of my life, that's out. That's out. Maybe it's a short phase. Who knows? But it's out right now. It is out. And you'll find that a lot of people are doing that, actually. They're deciding. They're saying, you know what? It's time that I really make some helpful decisions here. It could be little things, like the hot sauce. Little thing, but actually, is very helpful, very helpful. And the week break I took in Thanksgiving, I really was getting sluggish and losing my initiative, losing my will, and I decided, whoa, you know, you better get it back. Better get it back. Otherwise, we'll just drift. Before you know it, it's the 21st, and then right after that is what? Is Christmas on Tuesday, isn't it? 21st is a Friday, and then the 22nd, is Saturday, 23rd is Sunday, 24th is Monday, 25th is Tuesday. So you have that very quickly. Christmas right on the heels of that. And of course, you know, going through Christmas season, you can get out of your habits very easily. If you don't have your good habits established at that time, you could actually carry bad habits all the way into the new year and then through that. And you don't want to do that. You would want to be on point before Christmas hits. And then be able to carry it through Christmas and all the way to the new year. And I'll help you with that. I'll help you with that, definitely. I'm kind of a Scrooge as far as Christmas goes, because I don't believe that Christmas embodies I believe that what happened is with Christmas is that it actually has become a vast distraction from the whole remembrance of the important fact that there is a real plan for our salvation. And we can accept that plan and we're given help, a big boost to accept that plan. And what is that plan? It's an incredible distraction now. We do everything but that. Everything but that. So it's become really an antichrist type of situation now, the holiday season. Or very much an antichrist situation, meaning you're not really attuning to your freedom. Not attuning, in other words, the problem-free condition. You're not attuning to accepting reality as it is, which means problem-free, which is absolutely glorious and carefree for us, which is truth, which is the only truth there is. You're not attuning to that. You're turning away from that, frantically decorating, frantically cooking, frantically getting gifts, frantically spending money, checking your budget, rushing here and there, opening the present, eating. And maybe someone attends like a church service and they sing carols and then they go back home or something. That is so crazy. Really, what it should be is 2 weeks of quiet retreat. I'd love to head a retreat for Christmas, actually, where we actually focus on the extreme importance of realizing that even here in this world, it is possible to choose a new idea, experience the overlay, be reconciled back to reality, the problem-free condition, and to clearly see that all of existence is simple, a hypothetical scenario. That's all that it is. Trying to solve a problem that will never arise in reality whatsoever. That is all possible, even while you're here with the body. It is absolutely possible. And we're called to do that. We are called to do that. And that's what Christmas should be for. It should be a break from the hectic, frantic pace of life, where we're given the opportunity to not have to work, and not stuffing our faces, to really should fast for 2 weeks. We really should go on a juice fast for 2 weeks or something. Get into meditation, get into satsang, contemplation, and hear the message and start attuning to it like you've never had before. That is what Christmas should be about. And it's about everything but that. Everything but that. It has become an abomination. Truly it has. People say, well, I'm spending time with my friends and family and stuff. Yeah, but what do you talk about? You say, how is the time really spent? We can do that at other times. We just did it at Thanksgiving. So there has to be some part of the year that is set aside for like a jubilee, a couple-week jubilee of reattunement to our deepest focus and aim, our deepest aim, what we really want, to focus on what we really want, to remind ourselves, what do we really want? And then carry that into the new year and be determined for that new year to be an all-out effort. That's what Christmas should be. And it has become an abomination. Truly just awful. And I detest it. Absolutely detest it, what it's become. So if that makes me a Scrooge, so be it. Really, I pay no attention to Christmas the way it is now. I just try to maintain focus right on through it, but it's not easy. It's not easy. You're seen as being antisocial if you do that. Yeah, I've always been that way. When people get together, eat. Get all stupefied by that, and talk about movies and sicknesses, and gossip, and small chit chat, and stuff. Oh God, what a waste of time! What a severe waste of time! Severe waste of time, because we are in the crosshairs here. Death is stalking us every second here, and we are in a nightmare actually, because we continually will be faced with threats to our survival here. That is all that it is. That's what the purpose of existence is: continual threat. And we have the capability to see what existence actually is all about, and to choose a different scenario, choose a different idea. And choose to be reconciled to the problem-free condition of reality. Choose to take that path. We can choose that. Absolutely can choose that here, while we're here, and we're supposed to choose it. That's our responsibility, to wake up from this dream. So what better time than the holidays, where you're given some time off, supposedly, but I don't get time off. I have to work through the holidays. At least I have had to in the past. maybe a miracle will happen, and someday I might be able to lead a retreat. I'd like to, but who knows? Right now I don't see anything on the horizon, but stuff can happen. It's just amazing how people have capitulated in this world. They really have. Now, let's talk about why they have capitulated. There's a reason, and I've seen saw it today. Saw things more clearly than ever. The whole picture, so clearly. And it's kind of daunting, because what happens is you either wake up, you go down the path of waking up, and you wake up, or you go back into severe denial. Those are the only two options we have. Why? Because if we don't wake up, what happens is belief is our authority, our guidance. We look to belief as if it were the authority, the God, as it were. And the intellect belief tells us that the reason why we're struggling and suffering and being miserable is we don't have enough loyalty to belief. That is the reason. And we need to show greater loyalty to belief. And by doing that, belief will then hand out more advice and information as how to have a better life here. So we say, oh, okay, what do we need to do to be loyal? Then our goose is cooked at that point. Because what belief will tell you is to deny any other option, deny any other authority, deny the problem-free condition, deny that anyone's ever come here and represented this and showed us, presented it here. Ambassadors of Clarity never came here. They're all nuts. They're all crazy. They're all superstitious myth. And just forget about all of it, turn away from all of it, and focus 100% on solving problems here. That is what belief will tell you. And belief says, if you do that, it will inspire you and give you grace to how to solve problems, blah, blah, blah. You've heard the whole thing. They call it God, but it's not. God tells us how to get free of this delusion. That is a whole different thing. God says, don't worry about solving the problems here in existence. That's not the right path. Choose a different idea. Choose a different scenario. Choose to accept reality as it is. Choose to accept reality as it is. And the path will open up to bring you back to full reconciliation with that. That is the way. So what happens is you go into severe denial. When you decide not to awaken, you go into a severe denial. And that starts a new cycle. Cycles are started by actually denial. So when a group of people, aspects of spirit, who are engaged with this hypothetical scenario we call existence, decide that they want to continue on trying to solve the problem that they're working on, that this existence models, which is really annihilation, but it's just getting parsed out gradually, they decide to go into severe denial. And that starts another cycle of loyalty to belief, which means focusing on solving problems. And that's exactly what we have on this planet right now, is most of the planet is ready to go and choose severe denial, ready to go into severe denial, which is why it's a very dangerous time for those who do not want to go into that denial, and which is why we need a big boost. I'm doing everything I can. I need to do better. I need to pull out all the stops somehow, but I still have to be careful to not tip things in the wrong direction, too. It's not easy, but we need a big boost, because we do not want to go into denial, that path, because the denial becomes very severe. And remember the story of St. Peter after Jesus was arrested. They said, hey, there's another one. Jesus said, you'll deny me three times before the rooster crows in the morning, or crows thrice in the morning. And St. Peter did. He said, no, I never heard of him. He said, no, I don't know that. Never. I had nothing to do with him. I'm not the slightest bit interested. Nah, he's a scoundrel, whatever. He just rejected Jesus entirely. Deny, deny, deny. That is what happens. Because we're afraid. We say, oh my gosh, our advisor, that which gives us the right advice, how to escape. Maybe I don't know if I can make my escape. I'm not sure. So let me go back to what I'm familiar with, which is belief. And then belief will say, okay, I'm ready to advise you, but you haven't been listening good enough, and something's interfering with the effectiveness of my advice, and it's your fault, and here's what you need to do. You need to stop listening to anything else. Only listen to this advice and deny any other source of advice whatsoever. And just completely forget that any other advice is even possible. This is the only path you're on right now, solving problems. That's the only path there is. That's the path of salvation. In other words, commit to belief, to the false path. And so with that kind of pressure, and it says, if you don't do that, I'm going to abandon you, because you're hopeless. You're useless, hopeless, too stupid. I'm going to abandon you. You're going to be excluded. You're going to be annihilated, abandoned, annihilated, all these terrible things. So you're under this incredible pressure to deny, 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 deny. And then you go into another cycle of existence, of problem solving. So when we get to a point when we're ready for another cycle, the pressure is extreme, Pressure because people at that point want to commit. They say, okay, I'm all in. I'm going to commit all in. And this time it's going to be greater commitment, because that's what belief insists on. He says, you didn't succeed this last cycle because you didn't have enough commitment. So if you completely commit, this next cycle will succeed. And so people say, oh my gosh, I spent all this time this last cycle and I didn't succeed. Oh, how horrible. And then say, well, belief, well, how'd I fail? And belief says, you didn't commit to me entirely, totally. So you have to totally commit this time. And they'll say, okay. And then what do we need to do to commit? And belief will say, well, don't listen to any of these idiots who are saying other stuff, the spiritual knuckleheads, saying there's another path, talking about Christ and talking about problem-free, reality's problem-free, not to solve the problems of the world. And though they're all cult, fanatic, crazy, lunatic people who don't even pay any attention. Deny that anyone's ever come. It's all superstitious, magical nonsense, fairy dust in your eyes. Don't pay any attention to it. And they say, okay. And then also, it goes further than that, and they say, you know what? These people are so irritating. Just get rid of them. Get rid of them. Get rid of them. Slaughter them. Slaughter them. Slaughter them. That show your commitment. Show your commitment. You got to prove your commitment. And then I'll give you the, show you the right advice you need. And people will say, oh, wow, okay. Because I don't want this, I want this cycle to be my last cycle, so I'm willing to commit, go all in, commit. So we're at that time, that's why December 21st is so important, is it's the beginning of another cycle. And what happens is people will suddenly feel the sense they need to commit all in, which puts those who are going the path of salvation, it puts them potentially in quite a uncomfortable position of being looked at it as just completely crazy and dangerously crazy, and actually needing to vacate their bodies. The pressure will be on at that time. It's already on very strongly, but at some point it's the turnkey will be there, and people say, okay, I have to commit all in and prove my loyalty. And at that point, there's some possibility of danger, or difficulty and danger, and it's not going to be a good situation. So that's why the big boost needs to come. We have to be on point. We have to withdraw our consent from belief and give our consent to the grace of God, the path of salvation. Give our consent to the voice of clarity within, the clarity within that knows the truth. Give our consent to reality. And then we will be protected and helped at that time. But it is a wild, wild time, a very wild and weird time when the demand for the commitment comes. There will be a call for commitment. You know how in the revivalist meetings, the healing meetings, there's a call to the altar. And everybody, come on, you want to be saved, you want to repent, now's your time. So they lead up to that. There's a lead up to it. And at some point they say, okay, this is it. Here's the call now. And they make the call, and the music's playing softly, and people suddenly decide, I need to go get up and repent. You know, not a bad thing. I'm not putting this down at all. But you know what I'm saying. There's a point when the call is made. When the call is made, there's a time when it's made. Same thing with belief, with the intellect, with this hypothetical scenario. It will make a call and say, hey, it is time to commit to another cycle, to my authority, my guidance, this, the guidance of belief, authority of belief. It's time to make that commitment. What are you going to do? And then people will suddenly say, what do I do? And they'll fall back on either what is familiar or what seems to be not so fearful. If something's too fearful, they'll say, no, how am I going to commit? And then that's when things get weird and wild, and that altar call could happen any day. It could happen as soon as December 21st. It really could. It's an inner thing. It's a subtle thing where people suddenly say, you know what, I've made my decision. I'm gonna commit to something. Really commit. But you commit to belief. What does belief demand of you as a sign of commitment? Denial, 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 denial. And sometimes denial takes overt forms of action against those who do not consent to follow the authority and the advice of the belief, that terrible bully. Bully, the intellect, the belief, the false guidance, that which guidance from the insanity really is what it is. So we're coming up to that point really soon, really soon. Almost there, almost there. It's not a matter of years. It's not a matter of years. It is very soon as a new cycle begins. And so I've laid it out here that what it's all about, what it's all about. So hopefully you got this feeling like, whoa, there really is a reason to get with it right now. There really is a reason for that. It's not just throwing this out there with nothing to back it up. Okay, there is a total context for this right now. To be on point at this time, spiritually on point, as the advice that Jesus gave, saying there will come a time in this world, but basically you need to be spiritually on point, is what he's basically cutting through all the parables, cutting through all of that. You need to be on point, spiritually on point. In other words, you can't be carousing. You cannot be carousing. You cannot be weighed down by the wine of this world. You really have to be clean and pure and detached and feeling light and on point, clear, listening to the voice of clarity. You've got to be on point. And that time is super, super soon, super soon. So that you do not start plunging into denial, because that's a free fall. That's a free fall. So you can withstand that. So you can say no to that. No, 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 no. And consent to say, okay, I'm willing to go on the path that will take me to accepting reality as it is. I'm just be willing. That's all you have to do, is be willing. A little more willingness than not. That's all. Nothing more than that. You don't have to be a superstar. I don't feel like any sort of superstar at all. I feel like maybe I have a little more willingness to do that than not. Just a little bit. Hopefully, maybe. I'm still working like crazy on it. Tip the scales just so you have a little more willingness to accept reality as it is, rather than trying to work on solving problems here in this hypothetical scenario we wrongly call home, life, existence, etc. Just a little more willingness. So a little more effort on your part can tip the scales towards that direction. Absolutely can. Don't rest on your laurels. Don't take it for granted. Don't think, oh, I've made it. No, 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 no. Keep on pushing to the finish line, because at some point you will have to stand up to the demand of the commitment of those who've gone into denial. They're saying, no, you're what? How come you haven't committed? Or you have to get out of harm's way, really. I mean, it could very well be in harm's way for those who have committed. That of course belief is going to ask for a proof of loyalty, saying you have to prove you're loyal. If you prove you're loyal, this will be the last cycle for you. That's what it always says. It says that also with your life. It says, if you prove your loyalty to me, this will be the last lifetime for you. If you prove your loyalty, this will be the last cycle. Always says that, to hook you into it, to then get you to go all in with commitment, which then causes you extreme problems and actually ends up hooking you into more cycles and more lives. Have to stand up to that denial and sidestep it, probably sidestep it, because people will literally be told that the way to prove their loyalty to this monster, this monstrous bully of belief, this fake authority, fake God, fake, that they will need to get rid of those who are not committed to show their commitment. And of course, we don't want to be in harm's way for that. the Passover principle will protect us. At the same end, we don't want, it's always possible that we could waver. You know, that is possible. So who knows? Who knows what the big boost will bring? Who knows? But be ready for it. Be ready for it, because it will be necessary. It will be necessary. I've said in other videos in the past that the people of the world are actually preparing to prove their loyalty, and there's a lot of people who have been focusing on very violent stuff, very violent, brutal stuff. Almost like they're preparing. What are they preparing for? This is very strange. It doesn't add up. What's going on? Now we know what they're preparing for, because they feel like it's like initiation. They need to prove their loyalty to the authority of belief, thinking that will win them salvation. And they realize that belief is will ask them to brutalize, to be violent, to attack all things that belief has great attachment to, because it, you know, threat to life is all important in this scenario. The scenario is all about annihilation, and how can we survive annihilation? Because it's about changing reality, the belief that we can change reality, and how to deal with that changed reality. But actually, if we could change reality, reality would be annihilated. So it's trying to symbolize annihilation, which is of course death, destruction and death, and then have us continuously deal with that type of situation. And one of the ways that it tries to make us feel powerful is to bring death upon others, bring destruction upon others, thinking that somehow we're in charge of the destruction. So we're prior, since we're carrying out the destruction, we're prior to it. So therefore the annihilation of reality won't affect us, because we somehow are the annihilators. You know, see how that works? See how that works? So if we identify with being the attacker, with the annihilator, this, we feel like, well, no, we just annihilated reality, now we can create a new one. That's an insane way of trying to deal with it, but that is literally a way that you can look at it and wonder, why are people become so violent, so crazy? Because they feel like this is their salvation, that they're proving that they're the ones who are meting out the annihilation, and therefore they're prior to the annihilation. They must have a previous source, and they won't be annihilated. Something else is being annihilated. Reality is being annihilated, but they remain. So then they can create a new reality, and that's how we're supposedly going to survive the annihilation of reality. So of course those who are going down that path are practicing getting familiar with violence and mayhem in these video games, in this culture, in the movies, and so many different ways. I see kids acting out all sorts of violent moves. Young children, you see them with their parents, and they'll be like, wham, wham, cha. They're carrying out all these bizarre, violent motions designed to kill people, really. And they're kids, six-year-olds, five-year-olds, four-year-olds, young kids who are growing up on these super violent video games. You see them. I just watch them and just say, holy smokes. Look at the violence in these kids. The actions, the way they're acting. They're kind of hyped. They're very jerky. And they're just like, and they suddenly want to kill. Their attitudes are like that. They're getting ready for it. They're into the groove of that. So there's such a culture of violence, a culture of death, a culture of mayhem. It's all getting ready for this initiation type of situation that's coming up, where they feel they get to prove their loyalty to belief, also to try and establish themselves as the ones who met out the annihilation, and therefore not, the ones who are not being annihilated. And of course, they can't do this unless some other facets play the patsies for all this, play the victim for it. The victim and victimizer are two sides of one coin. It's an agreement. Because how can we model overcoming the supposed annihilation of reality if we don't have somebody meting out the annihilation and surviving it, and someone succumbing to it? And so the one that succumbs to it symbolizes reality. The one that survives it and mets out the destruction symbolizes that which supposedly prior to reality, which is the one that meted out the destruction, which then they can create a new creation, and then supposedly they will resurrect those who were victimized, who played the part of being destroyed, and they'll be resurrected into that kingdom. This is all completely bogus. This is all delusional. But victim and victimizer, I've always said, they're in cahoots with one another at a deep level, totally in cahoots. But you don't have to be in that game at all. You don't have to be the victim or the victimizer. You don't have to play the game of sacrifice at all. You don't have to play the martyr role at all. You say, okay, at your hand I die. I'll play the one that struck down. And you play the one that meted out the destruction. And then you will have survived the annihilation of reality. And you will create a new kingdom. And once you create the new kingdom, then you will resurrect me from the dead. And I will be able to dwell in that new kingdom. That is insanity. Total insanity. You don't have to play that game at all. I'm not playing that game. And truth does not call you to play that game. Salvation doesn't call you to play that game at all. Totally crazy. Because again, this whole thing is only modeling a hypothetical problem that will never happen. The annihilation of reality will never happen. Reality cannot be changed. So this is all a complete waste of time. Total waste of time. I may shift over to the song here. Because someone is coming here. Maybe you need some time to just dwell on this thought, because I've just brought up pretty much the believed in scenario in this world and just shown that it's completely bogus. How's about that for facing up? I don't know what kind of fear backlash I'm going to get for that. I wasn't intending to do this. It just came out because I saw it very clearly what's going on. Holy smokes. This is, of course, the biblical story. Pretty much what Christianity's talking about is the dead will be, all those who have been struck down and died will be resurrected, and they'll be part of this glorious new kingdom or something. That's nonsense. That's the game of victim-victimizer. It's a game of sacrifice. It's a game of annihilation. Game of surviving annihilation. It's all symbolizing, modeling how to survive the annihilation of reality. That's all that it is. And we don't have to do that at all. We can take the path of accepting reality as it is, instead of the path of trying to fix some imaginary problem that it will never have. The path of accepting reality as, which requires no sacrifice, it requires no attacker and no attack, no victimizer and no victim, no destroyer and no destroyed. No annihilator and no that which is annihilated. None of that. Doesn't require that play at all. None of it. It's free of it. So you're going towards being free of all that insanity, that completely insane game that's going on now. I may switch over for a second here to the song. Let me see. So think about this for a second in your quietude here.
Stay with it, you gotta stay with it. Stay with it, you gotta stay with it. Stay with it, you gotta stay with it. And the truth will stay with you. All through the day, just remind yourself, you gotta stay with it, you gotta stay with it. The climb is steep to avoid a fall, you gotta stay with it, you gotta stay with it. Stay with the truth, yeah. Stay with the truth, yeah. Stay with the truth, and the truth will stay with you.
Great. This is great. This is a breakthrough. I wasn't expecting it. This is a huge breakthrough. My gosh. I mean, it just cuts through the matrix. Totally. Totally brings to light the whole story of the victim and victimizer entirely, and shows what the game is really about. This is a home run. This is a home run. This is a grand slam. This frees me up from this paradigm that has been in control sort of a distortion of what Jesus came to teach, that Christianity distorted it, really. Talking about, how many Christian martyrs have there been throughout history? There's a book that details all of the number. It's an extraordinary number. And the idea that everybody who's struck down for Christ supposedly will be resurrected and part of the new kingdom. That's not it. That is absolutely not it. I always rejected martyrdom. Always. I said, that is wrong. It is wrong, wrong, and wrong. But I could never quite piece it all together until right now. Quite see it clearly. Why? Because there's so much pressure not to. I mean, are you kidding? Basically, you're going in the face with thousands of years of assumptions and supposed momentum, and just being a complete, absolute, total maverick. So no wonder why it was tough to see it, because it's so completely wrong. And it's so completely the belief system of belief. It is just like the opposite of truth. Opposite of truth. That's not the way of salvation at all. It's a way of trying to solve an imaginary problem that will never arise. So it seems to be a way of salvation, because it seems to give a way to survive annihilation. But it's all symbolic, meaningless symbolic gestures. But gloves seem to fit, right? Like, oh, but it's just madness. It's just made up madness that somehow the one that survives, the one who kills another, survives. The death didn't happen to them, so they prior to it. That means it symbolizes surviving annihilation and someone else. In order for someone to survive annihilation, something has to be annihilated. So therefore, there's death. People get killed. There's attack. It's all about attack and threat and all this kind of stuff, existence. It really is. It really is. So if you have been feeling this your whole life, you're vindicated, absolutely vindicated, because that is what it's all about. And then this is nonsense that the dead will be resurrected and then join in the kingdom. That is nonsense. Those who have died for Christ, etc., etc., all the martyrs, etc., etc., etc. No. Because when you're dying, what you're saying, oh, look, at the one that killed me is the one that lived, survived annihilation, and that somehow this magically means that there's some force prior to the annihilation of reality. Reality can be annihilated, but there's some force prior to it that did the annihilating. You see, it's all make-believe. It's all a pretense. It's made up. It's symbolic. We're just investing in it, trying to give it meaning. It's really crazy. It's meaningless. Because reality can't be changed in the first place. It cannot be annihilated at all. So it's completely meaningless on that viewpoint. And then the way we act it out is just nuts. You can see it's just an acting out of this insanity. So you don't need to die. You do not need to die. Even if someone doesn't strike you down, the world, age, disease, sickness, something strikes you down, right? You lose the body, you die, you say, ah, but something survived my death, you see. So there's something more powerful than destruction. Destruction happens, but something survives it. That's the whole story of existence. Because we are trying to find a way to survive the annihilation of reality, so we want to say, well, there's something prior, something carrying out the annihilation. And that's prior. And so that will survive the annihilation. So something is annihilated and something survives it. And that which survives it can then somehow resurrect or create a new kingdom and resurrect life within that new kingdom. Complete fantasy. And that Jesus had to have his name attached to all this. He said in A Course in Miracles, he seemed to express some great anguish, really. And he said, all the very, very dark idols that have been made in his name, all these very, very mistaken beliefs that have been made in his name, it really seems to bother him quite a bit. Which is too bad, because you shouldn't be bothered by it, because it's exactly what you should expect. of course, this it's just exactly what happens here. But hopefully, he sees there's somebody who sees through it, finally, and recognizes what nonsense it is. I believe that I would say what I see is, if Jesus comes back to this world, very few will recognize him. They'll think that he's a heretic, because he will not agree with all of these belief systems that have been put forth in his name, which really has been put forth by belief, and then claiming legitimacy by saying it's in the name of Jesus. This has all been done in Jesus' name. This is what he wants. This is what he's guiding us to. And Jesus will say, no, that's completely wrong. 180 degrees backwards. It's exactly what I came to warn you about. And so that's what I see it would happen. But I don't think he'll press the issue. He would simply gather those who see that this is true. This is true. And they would have to recognize that it really is Jesus, because he wouldn't be supporting all this stuff, and which might be difficult for some people. They would think, well, if Jesus comes back, he's going to support all the teachings and exactly how it is. And he'd say, yeah, you've done a perfect job. And no, would not do that. He'd be lying if he did that. He won't do that. So some might have a hard time recognizing him. Say, who's this? This is some heretic, really some lunatic heretic. And you have the whole situation all over again. Barabbas or Jesus? You want the murderer or the one who's says no, nobody needs to die, actually. Give up sacrifice, this nonsense. You may have the whole thing kind of denouement of the whole thing. It's going to come full circle, really going to come full circle. One time I had a dream, and I don't know what year it was. It was like maybe 4 years ago or something, 5 years ago, 4 or 5, I don't know. I was given an invitation, and I came to this party, and it was all the saints and the apostles, those who were close to Jesus, were there in this party. And they all welcomed me. Each one greeted me and said, welcome, welcome, welcome. We welcome you so much. It was an incredible reception. It was, I guess it was a reception of welcoming me there to that party. I said, oh, wow, this is great. What's going on? And I said, well, okay. And maybe I'm, thank you for the reception and welcoming me and accepting me. I don't know what to make of it, but maybe they were saying, you're worthy to be here because you've seen through the situation, kind of. Something like that. I don't know. I really don't know how things will play out. But that was quite an experience. I didn't know who the people were. I really didn't know. But the way they greeted me was the kind of greeting that would come from a very, very aware, clear, saintly type of person. With a lot of love. Real, real, real feeling of tremendous love. And it was quite an experience. It was a dream. But what to make of that, I don't know. But now seeing the whole paradigm of how things have gotten twisted is certainly an encouraging thing. For me, it's very encouraging. And I'll say it to anybody, I'm saying it right here to the world, that this is what's going on. And we can see it. We can see it. We can see through the whole situation, the ruse that we are using. We can see through it. We can see it, what it is, very clearly. It's not all jumbled up with me. It's all calm. It's all clear. So yeah, it's a matter of fact. It simply is a matter of fact. Saying that is, oh, so that's how we have been. That's the game we've been playing. Wow, what an awful game. Don't need to keep playing it. Don't need to keep playing it. Now, I hope a big boost will come. If not, I'm going to keep doing my very best. And it seems like every day I keep hitting home runs. I'm swinging for the fences. Really, I'm swinging for the fences right now, which means throw caution to the wind and say whatever needs to be said. If something comes up, I'll say it, which I just did. I say, like, whoa. Wow, that's not gonna, that won't sit well with some, for sure. But it will also probably sit well with others who have made space for this. And the big boost, in whatever form it comes, is certainly going to come to those who have made space for truth, and who have seen that this whole thing, this victim-victimizer thing, what a ruse it is, what a collaboration it has always been. With those who die feeling that they're going to have a great, great reward for dying. All death believes it's going to have a great reward, and it's just necessary. These two roles need to be carried out. Those who live on and those who pass away, to model a solution to this terrible problem of annihilation that we feel will happen because we want to be prime creator, and therefore we have to change reality. It's all there, black and white. Part of the problem here is those things that are in black and white belief claim insist that all must be all nuance and insist on all this nuance. And the stuff in this world that is really nuanced, very, very nuanced, belief insists is really black and white. So it's good things backwards, upside down and backwards. This here doesn't need to be nuanced at all. Truth does not need to be nuanced. Absolutely not. It's black and white. Very clear delineation, actually. Whereas the stuff in the world, oh boy, is it nuanced. All this belief stuff is so nuanced, and it tells us we're supposed to accept it as black and white, as obvious, where it's not obvious at all. All this agenda is utterly muddled and confused and nuanced endlessly. And we're told that we're supposed to see that as black and white, and we feel very confused, and then we become zealots, become severe zealots and fanatics and lunatics, and persecute others and call other people names as if, like, hey, you're trying to nuance it. This is completely obvious, completely black and white situation. Why are you trying to nuance it? That you're completely wrong for nuancing it. Making you feel stupid because you see, wait a minute. I look at the world and all these issues as very nuanced, but I look at truth, you know, salvation, as stark black and white, easily seen, very delineated. And the world sees the exactly opposite. They see these social issues as starkly black and white, and they see salvation as incredibly nuanced. They feel, well, how can we ever figure it out? It is so nuanced. And they go listen to people who nuance it for them, and they think, oh, okay, this is great. This is really getting somewhere now. And then, boo, 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 esoteric this and nuance that and blah, 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 blah. Very Baroque. Extremely Baroque explanations. But what we're doing here is we're just stark black and white. We don't need to solve any of the problems of the world. We don't just need to solve any problems at all. In the whole universe, none. We simply need to accept the fact that reality has no problems. The meaning, accept reality as it is, and it's easy to do that, and we will do easy to do that. There's a path, there's a way, there's help, and it's very simple, and we simply begin to celebrate, and again, who knows how the celebration will begin. I don't know. I don't have any set plans in my mind. I'm not mulling it over too much. It may just be an inspiration, just sort of kind of just segue into the celebration. Celebrate giving our consent to accept reality as it is. Just start celebrating it. Who knows how it'll happen? I don't know. But if it comes, it comes. However it comes, it comes. And we will certainly get with that. But we're laying the foundation for it right now here. Hitting home runs lays the foundation because it's like go time. It is go time now. So with that, maybe I can keep this at an hour. How about that? I know it's tough for you all to listen to these long things, but it's helpful because it keeps you in this mode, keeps you engaged, keeps you from drifting away into some form of entertainment, as it were. And entertainment, it's not good right now. It's not good. We need to get into celebration. Maybe I can start pumping out some more videos. Maybe I can make another channel, put a bunch of videos there for you, or put them up here. I don't know. I'll have to solicit comments on this at some point. Whatever, someone has an idea, I always listen to ideas. People have ideas. I do. I'm not necessarily always going to follow the idea, but I do listen. I do consider. I don't know if I should just keep this channel strictly for this, or should I use it for some kind of celebratory videos or something? I don't know. We'll see. Okay. Whoo. Incredible. polluted. The beans are spilled. The cat is out of the bag. It's really out of the bag now. That's awesome. That is great. Great to be part of that. And thank you, viewers, for being part of that too, because you are what is motivating me to keep on doing this, really. So my thanks goes out to all of you. And welcome to all the new subscribers, and bring some others in if you want to, because more the merrier. All right, that's it.